Holla at me.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You're tuning in to another edition of the Sports Shop 27. I'm your host, Jermaine Colter. And to the far right, my co-host, Kevin Johnson, KJ. And today's special guest from Calhoun County.
That's right, man.
Former Benedict College.
Absolutely.
New York Jet.
Absolutely. Hey, man.
Alonzo Shuler.
What's up, man?
Where y'all get those pictures from, man? Y'all dug those pictures up from.
Hey, he be doing his thing.
Absolutely. Hey, listen, you got my Shrine Bowl picture. Where you get that from?
Yeah, they took you back.
I'm the archive man, you know? I find them. I did
it. Dr. Dre over there, man.
I'm trying to tell you. Yes, sir. We're glad to have you on the show today, Zo. So let the people know where you're from and a little bit about your background.
Well, I'm originally from Newark, New Jersey, but I represent South Carolina to the fullest, man. South Carolina made me. I moved down here in the mid-90s and went to Calhoun County High School. And once I went to Calhoun County High School, like everything that you know, it was about me that was positive and football concern just kind of sort of blew up, man. You know what I mean? And, you know, I went to Benedict College after I left junior college. I was ranked one of the top players in the nation when I was coming out of high school, made a few bad choices so far as like not listening to my head coach, you know what I mean, getting my grades and stuff the right way. But I still ended up taking the long way and still making it to the NFL. So I'm blessed to be here. And I'm glad that you guys got me up here, man. I'm super excited. I've been talking about it. I just told my kids, I'm like, yo, y'all got to stay downstairs. Daddy about to be get interviewed. So I'm super excited, man. I appreciate you guys thinking about me in order to bring me on the show, man.
The show, man.
Yes, sir. We got a legend in the building today. So you started out playing what sport first, Lolo?
I started out playing football, but basketball was honestly my first love, man. I was a basketball. I mean, when I was in New Jersey, that's all I did. You know, up there, that's all we did was basketball. I was dunking the basketball when I was 11 years old. My son don't believe me, but I was dunking the basketball when I was 11 years old, and it kind of sort of just kind of took off from there. And then when I came and moved down south, it was just like, it was my athleticism for me playing basketball so much kind of sort of just, you know, put me in position to be a decent football player. And before I knew it, I was coming down south and I was playing varsity football, starting at middle linebacker as a true freshman in high school. And everything kind of sort of just took off from there.
Yeah. So what position was you playing in basketball?
I played guard, man. I played guard. And when I was in Pop Warner, I played quarterback, man.
All right, cool.
Yeah, man. Okay. So, that's where it all started from, man. It started on the Black Tops in New Jersey, man. And I kind of sort of just was one of those kids who had a lot of pent-up aggression, and football just came natural once I started, you know what I mean, actually playing on an organized level. I played Pop Warner in New Jersey and never really thought nothing of it, you know what I mean, because I love basketball more.
Yeah, but for sure.
Football, you know, kind of sort of took me there, you know.
Great. Yeah. So no baseball. You didn't play any baseball at all?
Man, no, man. Baseball too boring, bro. Oh,
man, come on, man. Baseball is fun, man. Too much standing around
for me.
I feel you, man. It's too slow for you. I feel you, like the excitement.
You must have pitch. You must have do no pitching or nothing like that.
Yeah, man. Nah. Pitching is the best position almost, man, for real.
I mean, you still got to sit around and wait all day. Football can go either way. Like, one second you're on offense, the next second you could be on defense. You know what I mean?
That's true. Yeah, for real.
So you played a little quarterback when you played football when you were young, right? You started out at that position. So most people, that's the best player on their team, play running back, quarterback, or, you know, they play receiver or whatever. But right. You started out at quarterback. So what age did you start making the transition on the defensive side of the ball?
Man, it was kind of weird, man, because my mom had just up and moved us from New Jersey to South Carolina. I ain't know where we was going. I was kind of sort of just like, are we moving to New York? Are we going, like, and then next thing you know, we're in South Carolina. And then, you know, Tony Felder, he's an awesome, most awesome person like I probably ever met in my life. And he's still in my life to this day. And my aunt introduced us and was like, y'all going out for football. Y'all not going to sit around the house. And then that summer of 94, 95, Coach Felder had took me under his wing and we went in bull in the ring drill. And I hit somebody and he was like, oh, okay. You know, okay. And you know, it just kind of sort of went from there. And then before you know it, we was in this spot called James Island, scrimmaging against Zola Davis. And he played for South Carolina, of course, and played a little bit in the NFL. And I think Drio was out there and they just threw me in there. It was like, man, you about to play linebacker. We need somebody to play linebacker. And I kind of sort of went off that scrimmage. And from there it was like, okay. You know what I mean? That's what it was. But, you know, I ended up eventually transitioning from standing up to putting my hand in the dirt.
Man, okay. That's what's up.
So which one you were more comfortable doing, standing up or both?
Standing up.
Okay. That Javon curse, right? Yeah.
Absolutely. Coming from the head. Because, like, you can see everything while it's happening. And yep. When you are playing defensive line, you got to be, you know what I'm saying? You got to be able to feel what's happening versus see it. Because if you start standing up and looking, now you're looking over the fence, you're going to get pushed a little bit. So, you know what I mean? I'm just more, you know what I mean? I'm more instinctive and I just got a knack for the football. So I played better standing up, but I kept getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. You know what I mean? So I eventually just moved to D end and D tackle.
Okay, cool. So you guys played, you know, at Calhoun County High School. Name some of your rivalries at the time.
Orangeburg Wilkerson, of course, couldn't stand nobody who played for them.
Oh, man.
Yes, sir. Oh, duh, baby. Yeah. Right,
absolutely.
Yeah, hey, we're going to give you a hard time.
Hey, but then, you know, me and Woodrow turned out. Me, Woodrow, Justin Dana, Jarrow, Raheem Alameen. Me, us three, well, Raheem and Woodrow, we ended up playing in the Shrine Bowl together, so we kind of sort of got close. But Justin was was somebody. Honestly, I hated OW, but Justin was like somebody who I grew up watching, like when I was at Calhoun County, and I was like, God damn, who's this dude? He big as hell. He got on the visor. I want to be like him. He's smashing people. So then we had opportunity to play against him. And both of us was on the same stage. And I'm like, oh, I got to outshine this cat. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it kind of went from there. But, like, Ellery had the Shivers boys, Bamberg, Barnwell, Edisto, you know, little small schools. Like
yes, sir. Yes, sir. So you went to the Shrine Bowl. You played linebacker. Got 3 sacks, 11 tackles. And a block punt. Talk about that a little bit. I was there that too. I was there that day. Yep, I saw the game. So
I was kind of mad in that game, man, because they gave Dedrick Wise the defensive MVP, and I was like, man, come on, Dedrick. Like, y'all know, I ball all the way out. I went from playing outside linebacker, middle linebacker, and I played defensive end in that game. I played 3 different positions, I had a lot of burn. And it was actually like, man, it was a real good experience for me, man, because just being honest with you, my last game as a senior, I cried like a baby because we lost to Mullins in the playoffs. And I never thought that I would suit up and play football again because I didn't realize how good I was or where I could have went with my career. Yeah. So my mom walked up to me and she was like, boy, what you crying for? Like, you about to go to college and play football. You better tighten up. So I'm like, all right, cool. So I kind of sort of snapped out of it a little bit. And then that following week, I got invited to the Shrine Bowl. And I was like, wow, you know what I'm saying? And then, you know, going out there playing with Jamal Reynolds. And shout out to Aiken High School. Jamal Reynolds, that was my dog. Richard Seymour. Cleveland Pinckney with Sumter High. Alex Fair, Al B's from Conway. I still keep in touch with a lot of those guys, man. And if y'all want to ever get them on, man, I'll definitely, you know, plug them in. A lot of them made it. Brian Scott. It was real cool playing with the top players who everybody thought, because they was at a bigger school than me, was supposed to be better than me. And I was out there outshining them all. You know what I mean? Yeah. So it was kind of cool. And also to get to know those guys, man. They were all cool guys, man. Richard and all of them, man. They me and Richard was roommates at the Shrine Bowl, and he was a really great dude, man.
Okay, from the University of Georgia. Go ahead, KJ. Absolutely.
Yeah. So who recruited you out of high school? Like everybody, all the schools.
Everybody. I was back then. Nebraska was the big deal. So Nebraska had just won 2 back-to-back national championships. And my friends still kind of sort of haggle me a little bit, because they say, oh, back in the day when we was coming up, you used to be a Nebraska fan, but now you like Alabama. Yeah. Well, I only like Nebraska because they was recruiting me out of high school, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
but I had offers from everywhere, man. When Clemson wasn't that great, I had offers from Clemson. I had offers from Notre Dame when they were like the top echelon of the schools. Alabama, Florida State, Georgia. I had every school in the country. Actually, after my sophomore year, I had every school in the country writing me. It was just that I was kind of sort of not as mature as I am now, of course, because I'm 40. But I wasn't ready to take on the responsibility of being a great athlete / student, or student / athlete.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? I thought that I was just going to be able to play football. And like I said earlier, I never thought that it was going to go that far, and I really wasn't that focused on my classroom. Even though I did well, I had to take the junior college route, and then I went to Copiah Lincoln, and I went to and then that's when I went to Benedict College, because my head coach from high school, which was Tony Felder, ended up becoming the head coach of the Benedict Tigers.
Okay, that's what's up.
Yeah.
Wow. So talk about that a little bit. You go to college, and your high school coach becomes your coach. Like, talk about that a little bit. What's that feel? How does that feel, man?
Man, it was too easy, because, you know, well, the thing was like, when he went in there to be the coach, and every, you know, he was recruiting really well, even though we didn't do that great as a whole, his 4 years there. We recruited a lot of great players, and everybody just kept talking about, oh, man, this kid, Alonzo Shuler, he coming in. So, you know, I come in, and they come pick me up from the train station when I was on my way back from JUCO. And as soon as I get inside the office and I'm talking to the coaches, one of the offensive linemen, he comes in there. He's a senior. He sizes me up. And he like, man, what's up? We can go right now. And I'm like, what? And I'm like, dang, y'all really on me like that? So I lined up with him in the office. He was way bigger than me. I slammed him on the table, and everybody started getting hyped. And then, you know, he kind of sort of gave me my respect.
Wow.
What? That's how you guys been?
Hey, man. That's
yeah, man. It was real funny, man, but it was real funny. You know, it was because, you know, once I was in college, I realized that, you know, I should have did a little bit better in the classroom. And that I really was a good talent, because if you know about Mississippi Junior College football, that's like some of the best JUCO football. Like most of those guys go straight
in the world.
Schools.
Yeah.
And as a freshman playing in JUCO, I ended up having 13 sacks and 77 tackles as a defensive end, and I had like 27 or 30 tackles in the backfield for losses. And I made the freshman all team. I made the all American junior college team and all that stuff. So, you know what I mean? It was just kind of sort of going to Benedict was like a walk in the park per se. You know what I mean? Because I always looked at it as if any of the guys who was on my team or who I could play against at Benedict could block me, then I didn't deserve an opportunity to play on the next level. You know what I mean? Not saying that they couldn't have had somebody special that played on the opposite side or even on my team. But I just felt like my talent level was a lot different from theirs. And you know, I should have been able to dominate that level, and I did.
Cool. So you get to Benedict, you go under Coach Felder. You guys played teams like South Carolina State, Florida A&M. Name some of the competition you guys face, and in that era, who was the powerhouse?
Tuskegee. Well, of course, South Carolina State beat the brakes off us every year. and it was kind of weird my first year playing against South Carolina State. I'm just going to talk about that real quick because my cousin Chris Rump, he was a D-line coach there. And so, you know, we were playing it, and some of the offensive linemen was talking about my mother. They was like, yeah, Ernestine and da-da-da-da. You know, they was calling my mom name verbatim. And I'm like, how the hell is... And then I started thinking about it. I'm like, okay, my cousin, he coached the D-line over there. So he just kind of sort of told him to mess with me a little bit. But that was a fun experience playing against South Carolina State at William Bryce Stadium in front of a whole bunch of people. Tuskegee was like one of the top schools, of course, playing in the Division II level. And they still are. Fort Valley State. We played against Virginia State at New York Giants Stadium. And what about
Fayetteville State?
Huh?
What about Fayetteville State? Did y'all play them also?
We played against Fayetteville State as well. We beat them in Charlotte. It wasn't that like division. I mean, not trying to be funny, man, but the Division II level was just super easy, man. And I kind of sort of set myself up to kind of do good things, you know what I mean? So that's why my numbers were crazy when I played on a D2 level, man. My numbers were crazy, man. For a defensive tackle, and it was crazy. My numbers was crazy.
Wow.
Cool.
Yeah, my senior year, I had 16 sacks as a D tackle. You know what I mean? And probably 40 pressures. Yeah, you know what I mean?
Okay.
Yeah.
Record-breaking numbers.
Huh?
So, I said that's breaking season-breaking numbers back then. So you guys played in the HBCU. What was it like playing against some of the fast receivers and some of the big linemen from Florida A&M at the time? Because I know they had a lot of guys that came from out there that went to the league too.
Yeah, man, it was a good experience. Like I said, man, you know, just for me, it was so easy. And I hate to sound like that, but it was real easy, man. I trained with this guy named Donnie Thompson, man. And he was like, at one point, he was the world's strongest man. And he had me geared up, man. I was squatting almost 1,000 pounds. I was bench pressing over 600. I was deadlifting 885. You know what I mean? So, you know, only thing that I was kind of sort of lacking, because I had gotten so big and powerful, my conditioning was a little bit off. But once I got, you know, got my conditioning all the way right, I mean, it was nothing, man. That D2 was like, it was a breeze, man. Whether it was even in the South Carolina State games that I played, the first game I had 2 sacks and I had like 13, 14 tackles. And in the second game I had a sack and like 17, 18 tackles.
Yeah, it wasn't no competition, huh?
Yeah, it wasn't, some of the South Carolina guys say, oh yeah, man, that was clean up ball. You got those. I'm like, yeah, right, okay. Say whatever you want to say. I got those sacks early in the game, man. I got the majority of my tackles early in the game. It was just that coach knew that I was, you know, I was fighting for an NFL job or some hooks. Yeah. So he left me in the game. And whatever I got in the third quarter, I got in the third quarter. Whatever I got in the fourth quarter, I got in the fourth quarter. But you know what I'm saying? Like I said, it was a good experience playing against Florida Atlantic, all of those schools, man. Everybody. It was a good experience, man. I even had fun playing on the D2 level. Just you know what I'm saying, being with all the friends that I have still to this day. Some of the guys that played with me in college, they still, you know, we still communicate on a daily basis. Our friends, my kids and their kids are best friends. Okay. And if you really look at it here in a second, man, I know this is totally off the topic, but I gotta give props where it's due. A lot of Benedict alumni kids are going to be very prominent in college sports soon to come. Like one of my guys who went to Benedict with me, his son signed with Wake Forest to play basketball. Another one of the guys from Benedict, his son is like the number one basketball player in the state of South Carolina. He's like number 5 overall in the country. My homeboy's son, which is my son's best friend, he's one of the top linemen, offensive linemen in Georgia. My son, of course, is the number one player in the state of Georgia as a rising sophomore. Yeah, and my twin brother's son is coming up. He's going to be one of the top wide receivers in the country. And there's so many more that I, you know what I mean, that that's just coming behind all of us.
Loaded, baby. Loaded over there.
See, you know what I mean? I'm proud of my college, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Hey, tell me about the Benedict homecomings, man. Y'all had a good time?
Man, we always have a good time because the biggest thing is for us is that, you know what I mean, we get an opportunity to see all of the people who we play ball with, you know what I mean? And who we kind of sort of, you know, had the blood, sweat, and tears and all our hiccups, all our good times. And we get a chance to, you know, kind of sort of reflect. We have a few drinks and laughs and stuff like that. And you know, we party real hard, you know what I mean? And we kind of sort of get back to it until it's over with, you know what I mean?
That's what's up.
So you go into the combine, had 16 sacks your senior year. The teams are looking at you. You kind of knew that you did your thing in college. Right. Talk about your feel, your approach to getting into the NFL at that point.
It was kind of simple for me at that point because at that point I knew that when like we had like 17 or maybe 20, maybe more that came to see me play in certain games. You know what I mean? Like when we played against South Carolina State, when we played against FAM, when we played against Tuskegee, when we played against Fort Valley, Albany. So they kept coming, you know what I mean? So I was kind of sort of always being prepped, like, look, man, you know what I mean? These coaches out here, so you got to, you know what I mean, get right. So when it was that time, and I was still training with the guy, Don Thompson, the first thing that happened was they allowed me to do the 225. And when they allowed me to do 225 and I did it 47 times and they didn't count 10 reps, everybody, the coach from the Browns walked up to me. He was like, man, I never seen anybody do it 57 times. He's like, I counted all your reps. I don't know what he's talking about. It was the guy from the Jacksonville Jaguars at the time.
Yeah.
He was actually heading USC's pro day, and that's why I did my pro day at USC, and then I ran a 4.8 sub, like a 4.81, 4.82, okay, at 323 pounds. And then it was so weird because that year that I came out, it was Sean Smith that came out and Langston Moore. They both ended up going to the NFL. One of them played with the Cowboys. One of them played with the Bengals for a very long time. And we all had the same agent, and our agent went and let them participate while I was there. You know what I mean? And I was like, and then they was just like, man, because your numbers was going to be better than these Division I players' numbers.
Yeah. So they didn't look bad.
They want you to go in there and kill their money. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so we went one-on-one drills, and I destroyed USC offensive linemen. And to the point where, after the third person I went one-on-ones with, I wouldn't let anybody else go. They would no longer even put none. They made their offensive linemen go to pass pro drills. And it was just funny, man. But that was the start of my beginning right there when I went there.
Okay.
And I had a good broad jump. I think I broad jumped like 10 and a half feet. And that 225 kind of sort of just blew everything out of the water. And, you know what I mean, from there it was just like, all right, let's make music. You know what I mean? So my twin brother was there. He was kind of sort of, you know, putting the battery in my back, you know what I mean, making me feel a lot more confident about everything that I was doing. So we was just putting on for each other, and we was like, yo, we're going to show these guys up. Like, they D1, it don't matter. We better than them. We supposed to be where they was at. We just didn't do what we were supposed to do in school to kind of sort of maintain those grades to get on that level.
That's right.
There you go. There you go, man. Well, let me ask you, what made you keep that intensity up, knowing that you deserved to play on that level and knowing that when you went to Benedict, you were going to dominate because you were already highly sought out as a high school recruit, you know? So what kept you on that discipline, on that edge to, you know, excel on the D2 level, even though it was easy?
It was two things, man. It was two things, really three. One, it was my mother. I remember when I was God rest her soul. When we were in high school, all of my friends, they kind of sort of had jobs. You know what I mean? And my mom, she was like, excuse me. Yeah, she was like, I'm not going to let y'all work. If y'all going to play football, play football. And she never allowed us to work. College, nothing. She worked endless hours.
Yeah.
We never wanted for anything. If we wanted for something, it was because we was just being selfish and we seen somebody else had it and we wanted it. Yeah. But she took care of us and that was the main
drive.
Yeah, that was the main goal. You know what I mean? Two, I had a really good defensive line coach, Keith Adams. Julius Adams, Keith Adams' father. I'm sure you know who Keith is, right? Keith played at Clemson, middle.
Yeah, that's my teammate. Yeah.
Yeah, Keith's father, Julius, was my defensive line coach. And he'd tear off, excuse my language, he'd tear off in my ass. He didn't care. Like, I don't care what you get your ass, you know, pow. Yeah. He's from old school. So,
he played in the league too, right? For like, right.
He played 16 years
for a long time.
Right. And he played with a few other teams as well. So he kept pushing me every day. You know what I mean? Even when I didn't want to do one-on-ones with a certain player on my team because I already knew that they couldn't block me. He was just like, nah, you're gonna keep sharpening your saw, regardless of what, because eventually you ain't going to be going against these same guys. But if you don't continue to practice on your technique and work on your craft, then you're going to be rusty when it's time to go against the better guys, and then you're going to get embarrassed. So that was like the second reason. And then the third reason was just my teammates, man. They wouldn't, you know, regardless of what. I had some really good offensive linemen that I played with, regardless of what was said. I had some guys that could line them up and play with some of the best of them, and they were nasty. You know what I mean? They probably didn't have the best footwork in the world, but they were real nasty, straight ahead guys. In a 90 set, they would smoke you. You know what I'm saying? They put that mitten in the middle of your chest or hit you upside your head, and you know what I mean? So they kind of sort of kept me real physical. They made me continue to be violent, because if I wasn't, they was going to handle me. You know what I mean? So those three reasons right there kept me hungry. And I also had some guys on my team who played on the defensive line who were strong as me or stronger than me. And so that kind of sort of kept me with a competitive edge. Like, I had to try to either keep up with them or do better than them. And, you know, we always competed against each other, regardless to what. So those were the main three reasons that kind of sort of kept me competitive, because my team always looked for me to make a play whenever we needed to make a play, whether we won or whether we lost. They always looked for me to, you know, I can recall, you know, coach calling the timeout, like, hey, look, man, we need the ball back. You know what I mean? Like, and he looking at me in my face, like, we need the ball back. And I'm like, all right, coach, I'm going to try to, all right, I'm with it. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Playing defensive line, you know what I mean? And you know what I mean? Having the opportunity to make an immediate impact right then and there at the you know, in the trenches, you know what I mean? I kind of sort of, that day, I remember we was playing against, Morehouse, and Denzel Washington's son was starting that running back, and they was like, man, we need it. And I bust through the line and hit the quarterback and made him fumble and recovered the fumble. And that was one of my highlights of playing in D2, man. You know, it didn't really mean much at the end of the day because it was Division II, but, you know what I mean, that's something that I can look back on and say, you know what I mean, that was something that I did that I can remember for the rest of my life.
Hey, so what was one of your favorite moves, man, coming off the line? Was it a swim move? What was your favorite technique?
The bull rush.
Bull rush? Oh, yeah. Wow.
Because I was, you got to think, I played linebacker. I was ranked the number two linebacker. I was ranked the number one linebacker in the nation, number two overall. Number one linebacker in the nation, number two overall in the country. LeVar Arrington was ranked number one. But I was real quick. I was real quick, and I had a really fast first step, and I was extremely powerful. So on the D2 level, a lot of offensive linemen on the D2 level can't handle movement. You know what I mean? They couldn't handle shimmy and the club and stuff like that when they trying to match feet with you. So that stuff came easy. But like, for me to just control another man and sit him down on his butt and get in the backfield and make a play in the backfield. That was my thing, man. That was my signature. Like, everybody knew I had offensive linemen. Even when I left the NFL for my short stint and went and played in NFL Europe, all of them used to come up to the line, oh, watch 96. He going to bull rush you. He going to try to bull rush you. Yeah. You know what I mean? They already knew what was coming. Because that was my go-to move. That was the move to set everything else up. I come off the ball, I bull rush, and then I'll use a swim move or a rip. You know what I mean? By that time, they setting so hard, thinking that I'm about to get ready to bull rush him, then I hit him with the finesse. You know what I mean?
So where you learn that from? Reggie White? Where you learn that from, man? LT?
It was kind of weird, man, because, like, you know, on a D2 level, even though I had a great coach, He was an old school coach, so he wasn't really that much, you know, of a technician and stuff like that. You know what I mean? So that's why I used the power when I was in college, because that's all that I, you know what I mean? That's all that I knew. You know what I mean? Like, he was just like, man, look, dominate him. You got to get movement. So that's what it was. But then when I ended up having the opportunity or a shot in the NFL, Ted Cottrell was the defensive coordinator. And my defensive line coach, Jesus Christ, I can't even remember his name. He was telling me, like, hey, you know what I mean? Using that finesse move is like ballroom dancing, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Kind of sort of taught me some things and stuff like that, that kind of sort of helped me along the way.
That's what's
cool,
up, man.
Cool. So you get to the Jets, you go in the locker room your first day. Who's in the locker room?
Man, how you know about all this, man?
Your teammates. I'm just asking, man.
Hey, okay, well,
I'm just doing my job.
The funniest thing, man, was that when I first walked into the locker room, me and my twin brother had the opportunity to get picked up by the Jets at the same time. So when we walked in the locker room,
wow,
I'm kind of starstruck because the first person I see is Curtis Martin. And I'm looking all like, man, look, man, calm down, man. We relaxed around here, man. Just do your job and you'll be all right. And so then he kind of sort of took me under his wing and introduced me to Vinny Testaverde and Curtis Conway at the time. And Curtis Conway was a real cool dude, man. He kind of sort of drove us around a little bit while we was up there in mini camps and camp and stuff like that. He drove us around. He had just got drafted. I mean, he had just got picked up from the Chargers. He was the Chargers' number one receiver, and the Jets had just picked him up. And he kind of sort of took us under our wing as well, under his wing as well.
What's up, man? That's good, man. So your first season with the Jets, what was y'all record? I think this was like 2003 or 2004.
No, 2002. We went to the AFC Championship game and lost to the Raiders.
Yeah, and then it was the the fumble with the Raiders and Tom Brady.
Yeah, that was my rookie season, man. I didn't get an opportunity to play as much because I kind of sort of struggled with some injuries and stuff like that. I had to have a few scopes done on my knee, and that's what kind of sort of held me back from playing that year. But I was a part of everything that was involved with it. Actually, Jonathan Goodwin, I think y'all had him on. Did y'all have him on yet?
No, we haven't.
I'm gonna get Jonathan Goodwin on here, man. He's a really good dude. He played center for the Jets. He played center for – matter of fact, when he was with the Jets, he played guard. And I used to rape him every day in practice. But he ended up being one of the better centers in the NFL, because once he left the Jets, he ended up going to play for Chicago, and then he ended up with San Francisco for a few years when San Francisco went to the Super Bowl with Colin Kaepernick and stuff like that. So so that was that year we were 12-4, and then we went all the way to the AFC Championship game that year.
And who was the quarterback at the time?
Vinny Testaverde was, but Chad Pennington was taking over.
Okay, cool.
Right, Chad Pennington was just coming in as well. He was like, it was like his second season.
Alright.
So you play with the Jets. You play with the big Hall of Fame Curtis Martin. Vinny Testaverde, University of Miami, Chad Pennington, Marshall. From there, you go to another team, or do you go to NFL Europe?
From there, I went to the Houston Texans, and then I went to Europe. Yeah.
All right.
My experience in Houston was really good. It was short because I continued to have small injuries. I had chipped the bone in my knee. I played in a few games, but I. I'm back. We here?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay. Yeah, I had chipped the bone in my knee. And so the Houston Texans ended up keeping me on to the end of the season, and then they released me. And then after I left the Houston Texans, then I went to NFL Europe and played for the Amsterdam Admirals for 2 years.
Oh, man.
Cool.
Yeah. How was that, man?
Amsterdam was cool, man. It was different, you know what I mean? Going someplace where nobody spoke the English language and stuff like that, you know what I mean? It was different. And, you know, just to go back a little bit, my favorite NFL memory when I was with the Jets, man, was we was in practice and Santana Moss cracked back my big ass. And I was he laid me out, man. He laid me out, man. And I spent that whole practice trying to get him back, man. The coach, Ted Cottrell, was like, man, he kept rewinding everything I was doing in practice. He was like, man, what the hell you got going on, man? He said, you doing shit like this, you're going to be on the first thing smoking back in Columbia, because I kept chasing Santana Moss around practice. I was trying to get him back, man. But
yeah, we gotta get even, man.
Oh yeah, man. You know, you talk about he like damn 5'7", 165 pounds. Yeah. He picked me up off my feet, bro. You know what I mean? He picked me up off my feet. But but NFL Europe was really good. It was a good experience. And once I kind of sort of played there, I did really well over there as well. And I had the opportunity to go and come back to the Jets, but I couldn't pass my physical. So, you know what I mean? That was kind of sort of where it ended at. But NFL Europe was good. I played in the World Bowl twice. We played with Kurt Warner. Harrison. James Harrison was on my team, number 92 from the Steelers.
Wow.
Yeah, we played from together. Huh?
Yeah, from the Steelers, yeah.
Yeah, and just from think about that.
Yep.
Yeah, just think about it, you know. A lot of people don't really know his story. You know what I mean? He went to Kent State, and he ended up going to the Baltimore Ravens. And when he went over there with us to NFL Europe, the Baltimore Ravens had allocated him over there. And he was over there. He was a blur in practice, man. Like, he – and in the game. Like, if you wasn't going 100 miles per hour, he was subject to hit you. Like, it did – like, he was that type of player, man. But – when he went back after he left NFL Europe, the Baltimore Ravens cut him. And now he, you know what I'm saying? And then he ended up getting picked up by the Steelers, being a special teams player his first year, and then all of a sudden becoming the Hall of Famer. That just speaks volume of his work ethic and stuff like that. So he was on my team. I was just glad he was on my team, man, because he dominated NFL Europe.
Cool. So I got a question for you. Okay. Who's your top five favorite all-time NFL players growing up?
Joe Montana, of course. Jerry Rice.
49er fan.
Yeah, man, you know, they got to be up in the top. Walter Payton.
Okay. Yeah, more definitely, yeah.
Lawrence Taylor. And I would say Ray Lewis.
Okay, cool. So, who are your top five favorite teammates?
In the league, when I was in the league? Or just period?
It doesn't matter. Period.
Kevin Mawai. He was a hell of a teammate. Curtis Conway was a good person. If I would have to go back to high school, I would say my twin brother. He kept me competitive, like, period. Like, we would fight in practice if he felt like my intensity wasn't high enough, or if I felt like his intensity wasn't high enough, we'll get into it, man. It'll be all out war. Let's say
you got two more.
I got two more? Thought yep. I had one more. This guy named Derek Darby, who played running back with me in high school, he was a really good kid. He ended up passing away prematurely. And probably
man,
one of
that's
my
that's the guy I got a picture with.
Yeah, yeah, number five. Okay. That was my guy.
That's the guy I was tackling in the picture, KJ. Yeah. All
right.
Cool. You tackled Derek?
Yeah.
Oh, man. Are you sure he ran you over?
Nah. I got the picture.
Yeah, and one of my guys from Benedict College, this guy named Brian Williams. He played offensive line. Yeah, he actually played at South Carolina State, and then he transferred to Benedict College. Brian Williams was one of the one of my greatest teammates. So, yeah.
Hey, that's what's up, man.
Hey, did you play against Michael Vick, man? Did you ever
I wish, man. That's somebody who I would have loved to play against, but by the time I was out of the league by the time Michael Vick came.
Yeah.
I got a chance to play against Brady and the bunch when Brady was young, and you know what I mean? So, you know, I played some good football.
Yeah. That's cool. Cool.
So what's your advice to a guy that's 6'3"? And, you know, COVID just happened. He's going to school online. Grades fell a little bit. Now his stock is fell. He's going to a HBCU or smaller school, not a D1. What is your advice for a guy in that situation right now?
Well, first things first is you got to be eligible to play. So, you know what I mean? You gotta definitely stay focused in the classroom, man. It's easy. Yeah. You know, HBCU is a little bit different. You know what I mean? You know, it's a little bit more wide open and there's not as much people around you to kind of sort of put their hands on you and govern you. You know what I mean? Accordingly, whereas on a Division I level, you know, you got people who checkers who check the checkers. You know what I mean? You know, my advice to them would be, you know, just to stay steadfast in what they're doing in the classroom. Bust your tail, you know what I mean? And do all the small things that nobody can see. Like when all your friends outside hanging out with the girls or with the guys or playing video games, watch that film.
Yeah.
Get in there, get in that weight room, do a couple extra reps. You know what I mean? And just remember that the NFL ain't promised to nobody. You know what I mean? I was fortunate to have a better background towards, though I was already being recognized as a high school player, as one player that could possibly catapult itself into the NFL as a, you know, after college. So I kind of sort of stayed under the radar a little bit. But, you know, for a guy who's on a Division II level, you just got to let it all hang out and let the chips fall where they may. And if you make it, you make it. If not, as long as you gave it your all, you know what I mean? That's all that matters, you know what I mean? Because there's a lot of people out here that's going professional and other things than football.
That's right, man.
Great advice. So it's game day. It's Sunday. What you got in your AirPods you listening to before you get on the field? What's your favorite tunes?
Man, Pastor Troy.
What? Oh, that's that era.
That was my era, Pastor Troy. Well,
uh-huh.
Yeah, vice versa, man. You know what I'm saying? Okay. Or some Outkast or some Jay-Z. But mainly it was Pastor Troy that had you, you know what I'm saying? You get in there, that vice versa, man. I had you pumped, man. You know what I mean? Sure, you know, for me, that's what it was. It was the Pastor Troy, you know what I mean?
Okay, cool. Did you listen to any other music outside the United States when you were in Amsterdam?
Not really, man. I mean, because, you know, over there, our time was kind of sort of limited. We were always in meetings and stuff like that. You know what I mean? It was a little bit more because over there you was actually auditioning to come back to the NFL. So even though I was allocated over there by the New York Jets, I was auditioning for all the other 31 teams as well, because you never knew what would happen. And you had to play great over there and watch the NFL draft, because you like, damn, all right, I'm over here. The Jets sent me over here. Well, let's see whether they're going to draft a D lineman. If they draft a D lineman, then I know I'm about to get cut. You know what I mean? Yeah. Because they're going to look after their investment. So, you know what I mean? You know, so that was about it for me. But so far as the music was concerned, you know, we kind of sort of – I didn't even have a chance to listen to that music that much at all over there, because their sockets over there was kind of weird. So I bought a radio over there, but it was from America, and they had different sockets, so our radio couldn't plug them into the wall.
Dang.
It was weird, man. It was weird, but it was a great experience, though.
Yeah, man. I got a question. So what's the key to being a good D tackle, man, for some young kid that's watching right now?
Well, pad level. It's a few things. Like, you got to be defensive tackle on any level. Everything happens in an instant. You know what I'm saying? It happens really, really fast, and it's really violent. So if I can tell them to give them any advice, it would be play with good pad level.
Yeah. So have to play low.
Play low. Absolutely. Okay. Play low. Use your hands really well and get off the ball. You know what I mean? Don't sit back and wait for that, you know what I mean, that collision. You know what I mean? Attack the line of scrimmage. You know, also depending on what type of scheme you're going against. If you're going against zone block and stuff like that, you got to kind of sort of move, be able to move a little bit lateral more than anything. But for the foremost, it would have to be ready to play physical and violent at the point of attack. You know what I'm saying? You have to be able to kind of sort of be in sync with your strike timing. You know what I'm saying? Your hand strike timing to the offensive lineman pads. You know what I mean? So that would be it for me. You know what I mean? And chase the ball.
Stay on sides too, right? Stay on sides. Hear that count.
well, don't listen at the count.
Don't listen to the count, man.
You gotta turn your eyes down the line of scrimmage and look at that ball, man.
Look at that ball, baby. All right.
Absolutely, because you're gonna jump off sides all the time, and that's one thing I always try to teach my son. You know what I mean? But one thing about him, he's a very disciplined little kid, and so his biggest thing right now is his conditioning. So I always tell him, like, you got all the tools and intangibles, but you just gotta put it all together with your conditioning as well. So, you know what I mean? So for a good defensive lineman, I would say those few things, like, you got to be in shape, you got to be powerful, you got to be real strong, and you got to be technically sound. You know what I mean? Because if not, you're going to get washed. You know, in the NFL, a combo block feels like a double team, but it's really not. They just trying to get up to the next level. You know what I mean? They taking you with them. So, you know what I mean? You got to be able to distinguish the two.
Man, that's good stuff, man.
Yeah,
real.
So I know you're a big guy, you know what I'm saying? So what's your favorite pregame meal?
You know what? I was one of those people who hated to play.
Full.
Yeah, man.
Me too. Right, me too. So if I ate a decent breakfast, and I probably had, you know, depending on the time of the game, I would probably have a few bananas, couple bottles of Gatorade.
Yeah, you don't want to cramp up. Yeah, for real.
Yeah, and some electrolyte tablets or something like that to kind of sort of go with amino acids to keep my body hydrated, and that was it. You know what I mean? I didn't like to really eat before the game.
Yeah, cool. Stay light as possible, man.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So where can the people find you on social media, man? Some of your family, friends, and fans. Where can they find you at on social media?
I'm on Facebook, Instagram. I ain't got no Twitter and all that good stuff, and because I don't think I'm that important anymore. But Facebook, Alonzo Shuler. Instagram, Ernie Baby Boy. That's my mom. Her name's Ernestine, so I just, you know, put it under there. I'm her baby boy out of four. So Ernie Baby Boy. And that's about it, man. I'm on there often. I like to have a lot of fun on there. I crack jokes on there a lot. I do a lot of inspirational stuff on there as well, like, you know what I mean, quotes like that, you know what I mean, just to kind of keep motivated to get their day going, man. You know what I mean? It's hard out here sometimes for people, you know what I mean?
Right.
And you never know what
what might
inspire somebody. So
to keep going. That's
absolutely
right.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely.
Very important.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, we appreciate you coming on the show, man.
I appreciate
it's been a minute since we talked. Yeah, no problem, man.
Hey, it was kind of weird because when it was introduced to me, I was like, I know him. What are you talking about? Like, you know what I'm saying? Tell him I said hit me up, man. You know what
you know.
Absolutely, yes, man. I definitely, man, I appreciate you guys for the opportunity, man. This was super dope. And you know what I mean? I promise you this, everybody who I know, all of my family who played in the NFL, I'm going to tell them to hit y'all up, man. This is something that's positive. You know what I mean? It's something that can give insight to kids that's coming up behind us.
That's right, man.
And it's just great for conversation. You know what I mean?
So, yes, sir.
Absolutely. You guys brought up some, some memories for me. You know what I mean? So that was cool.
No problem, man. That's what we're here for, man. You always welcome to come back to the shop at any time, man. Also, we can get your son on. That'll be great too. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I know he's going to be the next number one draft pick. Yeah. You know, coming in a couple of years. Congratulations on the hard work putting in on your son. And shout out to your family and your brother as well. We'd like to have him on the show as well if you can extend the invite to him.
Okay. Get him on here.
And we might get both of y'all on at the same time so y'all can tell some of y'all funny stories and stuff. I know y'all boys got a lot of stories. That would
definitely be funny because he's going to definitely have a different view than I have.
I know it. Yeah, man.
But I appreciate it. I'm definitely going to get my son on here. And because he's really putting in a lot of good work, man. As a freshman, he's front squatting 335. He's back squatting almost 500. His bench press ain't where we wanted at, but he's getting up there. We're trying to get him to like 315 before the summer's over with.
All right.
285 right now.
Yeah.
Power cleaning about 275. So you know what I mean? For a freshman, I think those numbers are good, but we trying to work a little bit harder to get a little bit.
Still some more work, man. That's cool.
Yep. Yeah. He's still young, but he's still developing. It takes time to just stay healthy. That's all we need to do. Keep the grades up.
He's almost 6'6", 260 pounds, man.
Dang.
Yeah. Hey. Absolutely, man. But we definitely going to get him on, man. Like I said, I appreciate you, KJ. And bro, I appreciate you for reaching out to me, man. That's big. You know what I mean? Sometimes this is therapeutic. You know what I mean? Because a lot of players that don't play in the NFL anymore sometimes struggle with depression. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. They don't know which way to go after sports. Something like this big right here can actually give them an opportunity to relive some of those moments and kind of sort of, you know, bring a little bit of joy back to their life, man. So if I was y'all, I'd continue to reach out to everybody, man, and on every level, you know what I mean? On every level, you know what I mean?
Yeah. It don't matter, man. What sport? It don't matter. Any
absolutely,
sport.
Bro. Absolutely, bro. This is big, man. This is therapeutic. I appreciate it, man.
No problem, man. We always love to have you back on the show. Make sure you stop by our sports apparel shop. Just hit the shop button on the Facebook page and just go ahead and pick your size. Got some fly stuff in there, man. Probably like 7-14 days shipping. But we'll get to you. You know what I'm saying? It will get to you. Most definitely. Look,
I told you I'm a big supporter of anything that's positive, bro.
Yeah. You
know, that's just me. That's just me, you know.
That's how you roll.
Anybody who knows me, they'll tell you, like, to know me is to love me. And I'm all about making a change and doing positive things, man.
Yes, man.
Well, man. Well, we appreciate it, man. You guys have tuned into another edition of Sports Shot 27.
Yeah.
I'm your host, Jermaine Colter. My co-host, Kevin Johnson, KJ.
And we Alonzo Shuler.
Yes, sir.
Right, baby.
And it's also our motto. Our motto on our show is what, KJ?
Hey, it's not how you start, it's how you finish.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Right, baby. Always.
Yeah.
Thank y'all for having me.
Hey, subscribe to us. No problem. Subscribe to us on YouTube, Spotify, and Deezer. Until next time, see you later. Wear your mask. Peace.
Peace.